We are going to settle ourselves and settle our hearts and our minds, and as we come into this place and this space to worship Almighty God. Whoever is obedient to his word, in him the love of God is truly made perfect. Choir now going to come and sing Be Still for the presence of God.
Take advantage of anyone. Do crush the deaf? Or could something in front of the blind so as to make them stumble over it? Obey me, I am the Lord your God. Be honest and just when you make decisions in legal cases. Do not show favoritism to the poor or fear the rich. Do not spread lies about anyone. And when someone is on trial for his life, speak out. If your testimony can help him, I am the Lord. Do not bear a grudge against others, but settle your differences with them, so that you will not commit a sin because of them. Do not take revenge on others or continue to hate them, but love your neighbours as you love yourself. I am the Lord.
Thanks, Laura, and thanks be to God. Let's sing our little invitational, or at least a verse of our little invitational hymn 198, Let Us Build a House. Congregationally 544, if you have a hymnal, and it's on the screen, and I've just remembered what you said last week, so I'm just going to announce it. We'll put out hymnals just in case people can't see the screen for the future, but we meant to do that, but anyway. Okay, so it's 544 if you have a hymnal in front of you, and if not, it's on the screen. When I needed a neighbour, were you there?
Hungry and thirsty where you live.
ourselves as we come before God in a time of prayer. Lord God and Heavenly Father, we give praise and we give thanks for the joy of coming into your presence and for the joy of being with one another. Yet we recognise, Father, that there are many who are struggling in this world, and there are many who are struggling within our own congregation and amongst our family and our friends. And so as we rejoice in worship, we remember them, your people, feeling the impact of this world as all peoples do. But help us to understand that we are not alone in this universe, that we have you. We have your Spirit and we have Jesus. And we thank you for all that you represent, one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And ask in this time and in this hour that you give us a deep sense of your presence, that you speak to us not only through the voices of men and women, but you speak to us through your word, and that you speak to us by your Holy Spirit. When we go around our daily lives, O Lord, there is much to distract us from you. But we try to be still, because the presence of the Lord is moving in this place. Move amongst us, O Lord, and forgive us our lack of faith, our frailty and our weakness. Forgive us, O Lord, our sins, whether deliberate or not, knowing that through genuine repentance and faith, we are forgiven. A forgiven people who can go forth into the world with a sense of purpose, not alone, and to share righteousness, not that which is our own, but that which is given to us through Jesus Christ. So for all these blessings, O Lord, we praise your holy name. That is our purpose in worship, to praise you and to give thanks for being with us through good times and through bad, for that sense that we are never alone, and for that hope that you give each and every one of us for a better, brighter, and new tomorrow. Comfort those who need comforting and give us strength to do what you would have us do. And this prayer we make in the name of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Angus and Andrea are coming to the
Good morning.
Good morning.
And this song is called Build Your Church.
Oh Christ alone, our chief cornerstone, no other foundation. Thank you.
Steve is now going to come and read to us from 1 Corinthians 3, 10, 11, and 16 to 19.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to Christ's Church in Corinth. Using the gift that God gave me, I did the work of the expert builder, and laid the foundation, and another man is building on it. But each one must be careful of how he builds. For God has already placed Jesus Christ as one of the only foundations, and no other foundation can be laid. Surely, you know that you are God's temple, and that God's Spirit lives in you. So if anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him. For God's temple is holy, and you yourselves are his temple. No one should fool himself. If anyone among you thinks that he is wise by this world's standards, he should become a fool in order to be really wise. For what the world considers to be wisdom is nonsense in God's sight. As the scripture says, God traps the wise in their cleverness. And another scripture says, the Lord knows that the thoughts of the wise are worthless. No one then should boast about what men can do. Actually, everything belongs to you. Paul, Apollos and Peter, this world, life and death, the present and the future, all these are yours, and you belong to Christ, and Christ belongs to God. This is the word of the Lord.
Our gospel reading this morning is from Matthew 5, 38 to 14, of course, that's on the screen. You have heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you in the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. If anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbour and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even the pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your Father in heaven is perfect. Amen, and thanks be to God, and may he bless to us all of these readings from his word. Let's have our usual short prayer. Let's pray. Lord, be in our hearing, but also be in our listening. Lord, be with us in our thinking, but also in our understanding. And Lord, be with us in our hearts, but also in our doing the things that you would have us do. In the name of and for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Saviour. Amen. Build the walls, draw up the bridges, man the ramparts, and create as much distance between us and our perceived threats. When you look around the world, it seems that that's very much the policy of politicians and all kinds of world leaders. People reluctant to open their arms to others and call them friends, but rather call them enemies. But it's pretty much the way of the world, isn't it? And if we look around, we see it in so many different situations. The world today feels very fragile and unstable. But is there not a sense in which that's always the way it's been? Do you remember this man, Private James Fraser, a.k.a. John Laurie, and a programme called Dad's Army? He looked at life's situation and says, we're doomed! We're all doomed! And things don't seem to have changed much. You know, that was Private Fraser's attitude towards the troubles of the world. And some people today still adopt that kind of attitude. We're done for, we're doomed. So why bother doing anything friends, the reality is mankind has a very checkered history. There's no shortage of failings throughout the annals of history, both secular and sacred. And that's why God takes it upon himself not to leave us to the ravages of our own base nature, but calls us to be inspired to look to live a different way. And if we are to build his church, we have to present to the world a different picture of how it can be. We have to be a different kind of people. Not a people who, as I keep saying, have a sense of self-righteousness and look down their nose at everybody else. God knows the church has made that mistake throughout history, time and time again. But different in the sense that people look to us, they see our hope, they see our joy, even in the midst of our pain, and say, what is it that these people have that we do not have? And of course, what we should have is Jesus Christ in our lives. A sense of his saving grace. That grace that stops us doing what we shouldn't do and helps us to do the things that we should do. In our reading from Leviticus, we see that the people of God are given a series of rules. And of course, if you're on the ball, you would have seen that those rules that we had read to us were based on the Ten Commandments. And later, what happened after the Ten Commandments were given, the people had these rules developed so that you could put them into practice in terms of everyday living. Put them into practice so that by doing the things that God wanted of them, they could be distinct from the people that were around them. Now, of course, if you read your Bible, and particularly your Old Testament, you soon come to understand that a people set apart do become a haughty, self-righteous people and miss the whole point and start looking down their nose at other people and get into bother for it because they're not doing what God required them to do. Their distinctiveness was for another reason. Be holy because I, the Lord, your God, I'm holy. There's your reason. Be holy because I, the Lord your God, am holy. You see, the whole of what's referred to as the holiness code encourages laws, rituals, and liturgies that acted as an outward manifestation of the holiness of God himself. It was expected that the purity of God's people would be a very much part of their life which was reflected outwards and others could see them as someone or peoples who witnessed to the reality of God because only God could make them so distinct. It was used to raise the question in people's mind, what makes these people different from the rest of us? Now, we have suffered in our country because we are traditionally a Christian country, aren't we? And so everybody thinks that makes you Christian. You're born in Britain or America, for that matter. And because you're born in that country and it's a Christian country, that makes you Christian. That's actually a heresy. It's totally unbiblical. You don't adopt Christianity by birth. It's something that's adopted through a relationship with God. Whether that relationship started at an infant baptism or an adult baptism doesn't really matter too much. But that relationship has to start. And of course, traditionally, in the Church of Scotland, they would start at baptism, and the idea was that the children would be baptised and the parents would take the vows to bring their children up in the Christian faith, and they were brought up in the Christian faith, and they would come along to the church, and they would go to Sunday school, and then they would join church organisations, and then at a later stage in their life, they would have their confirmation, and they would all turn into good Christian people. It's not working anymore, is it? People bring their children to church to be baptised, and it's been my experience over the last few decades anyway, they never come back. The children are not brought up in the Christian faith because not only do the parents not worship on a Sunday, they don't actually share Christianity with them at home. And then we sit here as an older generation and say, where have all the children gone? Well, where all the children have gone is into the world. They've gone into the world and doing the things that the world do. Never talk about Jesus Christ. I've never heard the name of Jesus. And the effect of secular teaching, if you like, is so all-pervasive that even children who are brought up in Christian homes, even the children of ministerial families, have the Christian aspect of their life squeezed out of them by worldliness. And that's why they're not here. Because they've not been brought up in a distinctive environment. There is no difference between home life and life in the world. And so if we are to build our church, we need to be a distinctive people. And if that scares you, then that's why I'm here. You come and you talk to me about what makes it scary. What's so bad about what's so difficult about walking the Christian walk. Remember I said a number of Sundays ago that the original Christians were not called Christians. They were referred to as children of the way. We're on a journey with Jesus. Now that excites me. That excites me, walking the walk with Jesus, living the life with Jesus, been out in the world talking about Jesus. I find that really exciting. Then I joined the Church of Scotland, become a Church of Scotland minister, and we're all static, aren't we? We're all stuck. And people tell me on a regular basis that the reason that people don't come to church is it boring and irrelevant. So, nobody comes to hear me because they think I've got nothing to say. And even if they do believe that I've got something to say, then somewhere in their head, they believe it's a waste of their time. That hurts. Going to church is a waste of time. Are you wasting your time? So how do we get that across to people that it's not a waste of a time? I mean, I've started saying to people not to come on too heavy, you know. Just think about it. You're lying in your bed Sunday morning, usually from a heavy Saturday night. And you're sleeping the daily. At the very least, getting out of your bed and coming along to church and mixing with other people sets you up. Sets you up for a better week. Is she okay?
Sorry.
So in a small way, you being here is the start of being distinctive because you can be bothered. You think it's relevant and hopefully you take something away from it. It's something worth doing. But being different's hard. And it's harder for young people than it is for the older generation, because young people don't like to stick out. They want to be part of the gang, they want to feel included, and to say, well, I'm not doing that, or I'm not doing this. Why are you not doing that or doing this? Because I'm Christian. And I'm not talking about the kind of things that Chuck said, oh, you shouldn't be doing, because that's no Christian. You know, there was a day, I like a dance, you know that by now, hopefully. I like to boogie. But there was a day in the chapel, don't dance. Don't go to the cinema, because that's worldly pleasure. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the stuff that, as Christians, we exercise to try and live up to a holiness code. You know, I'm not going to behave riotously. I'm not going to get involved in activity that's on the fringes of criminality. I'm not going to abuse myself. I'm not going to disrespect other people. The things that young people have to grow through, for young Christians it's hard to say, no, I'm not doing that. And so we have to support them. And I think the church has failed our young people. That's what I view. I mean, we tend to go, oh, these young people. But Jackie and I had an experience. I took her out for his Valentine. I'm off script now, guys, so we could be here all day. I took Jackie out for Valentine's. Not on Valentine's Day, because Tuesday was too busy. But we went out on Wednesday. And I took her to a place, I don't know if you know this, Creepy Wee Pub. You know it? So we went to the Creepy Wee Pub in Dunfermline. And we were surrounded by young people. I felt like granddad in the corner. We had a fantastic night, and I just felt fatherly, I felt pastoral, because I saw all these young people who I assume are unchurched, coaching, having a good time, old mate, singing. One young guitarist there, Angus, absolutely fantastic. Made this guitar sing, young fella. And they were all having a good time, and I turned and I said to Jackie, what I find interesting is that when I was a boy, I remember going into pubs, and it was drunken men drooling over bars, doing swearing and doing this, that, and the next thing, and staggering home to their poor missus with no money left and all the rest of it. That's what I remember, right? And here we are in the Creepy Wee Pub, young people having a good time, nobody disrespecting anybody. Younger generations very hugging one another. And I just felt, my heart went out to them, because, you know, in churches we have young people. And they were all respectful, despite the alcohol. So my view is that we fail them. So I've got a new mission. I'll be going to the PPB pub a bit more often. And if the opportunity arises for me to talk about Jesus, that is exactly what I'll do. My wife's going around telling everybody I'm a minister in the Church of Scotland, sitting in there with my fifth or sixth Jack Daniels and Coke. It's hard for them to be different, but we are called to be different. And we need to look at how the church can be different. And I suppose that relates nicely, doesn't it, to us maybe having a wee go at a cafe church in a few weeks' time. Because God wants people to look at us and say, even if I don't agree with you, there's something positive in the life of these people. So as God led his people, they were called to be a people apart, a holy people who were to reject the carnal excesses of the world and transcend towards more heavenly aspirations that make us more than animals. Now there's a key modern thought, because we're told we are just animals. We're evolved animals. We're evolved animals. But God's saying you're not just animals. You're something else. You must not live according to the customs of the nations I'm going to drive out before you, because they did all these things, all the things that I abhor. I am the Lord your God who has set you apart from the nations. I think in churches we have lost a vision of God himself, because the world has squeezed out the space that we used to have in our communities to take time to be with God. Not just on a Sunday, but going around our business. Goodness gracious me, I'm old enough now to remember the days where we used to actually pray in school. Do you remember those days, guys? Yeah, you take your chairs off your desk and the teacher would lead you in prayer. You would go to a school assembly, and usually you'd go to tears, but nonetheless you were at a school assembly and the minister would speak to you about the things of God, one would hope. And I remember my first spiritual experience being going to a school assembly in a church, strangely enough, when I was just a wee laddie. And the first hymn that ever touched me was an Easter hymn. There is a green hill far away. That was the first hymn that ever touched me. God never said anything much to me after that for a while, but people were exposed to the things of Christianity that they're not exposed to anymore. And people have said, oh, we need to get religion back into schools. Well, we've got a big political problem there. That environment doesn't exist anymore. And it might be more helpful for us to think of ourselves living in a post-Christian society than a Christian society. And if it's post-Christian, then that means we have to get back on with spreading the gospel again. And if you're feeling a bit discouraged at that, just remember that the church waxes and wanes. There's ups and downs throughout history. And God often says to his people, as we see here in Leviticus, in fact, back you come. This is the way I want you to live. This is how I want you to be. I want to read to you just very briefly a small passage from the Bible, the Message translation by Eugene Peterson, who kind of takes the passage that we're looking at and says, holy is the word that sets God apart and above our attempts to enlist him in our wish fulfillment fantasies or our utopian schemes for making our mark in the world. Holy means that God is alive in God's terms, alive in a way that exceeds our experience and imagination. Holy refers to life burning with an intense purity that transforms everything it touches. And can you see how that nicely merges what we were saying a couple of weeks ago about being salt and light? And nowhere did things burn more intensely than in the person of Jesus Christ. Here's the thing. By the time we get to Jesus, God's relationship with those he has called is deeper and demands greater transcendence than under the old covenant. There's a step change between the relationship that God had with Israel and the relationship that he has with his people. You have heard what it is said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. And what that means basically is we have to avoid evil. Jesus is the one who has authority to interpret the very law that the Old Testament has, because he is the fulfillment of that law. And he characteristically continually calls us to focus not on outward behaviours, but inner attitudes and motivations, because it's them that leads to action. Do you see the difference? That it's under the law, it's about outward, it's about appearances, it's about seeing to do what's right and not getting caught. And God is saying, nah, it's not about just seeing what's right and not getting caught. It's about looking at your own heart to ensure that these things that come to law breaking and all the rest of it don't happen in the first place, because you're a transformed people. He teaches his disciples to be perfect. Now, that's a high demand. We've touched on it before, but it might be helpful to take you a wee bit deeper by saying that when you look at the Greek word for perfect, it's translated perfect, but the Greek word is teleos. And teleos has connotations of completion and wholeness. So when Jesus says, be perfect, he's actually saying, be whole. Be complete as your Father in heaven is complete. And that makes a lot of good sense, doesn't it? Because there's not one of us in here who in some way or another is broken or has been broken. And we're called to become whole like God himself is whole. So we're on a path with God to be a people that reflects who he is and are different from everything that's going around, in the sense that people stop and think, they have something to say, they behave in a different way, what is it about you that makes you the way you are? And when somebody asks you that question, what do we then do? What is it that makes you the way you are? God. And William Bartley, he kind of sums this thinking up by saying, only the grace of Jesus Christ can enable you to have the unconquerable benevolence and the invincible good will only be achieved by your personal relationship in Christ Jesus. We are Christian because Jesus makes the difference. So if we have to build our church, we have to break down the walls, put down the drawbridges, leave our ramparts, and go out into a hurting world with the good news of the redeeming love of Jesus Christ. And that's why in 1 Peter we read, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into a wonderful new light. What a vision of the church is that? To be holy, to travel with God in a journey, and to be powered by not our own self, but powered by the Holy Spirit, that we, in our weakness, can make a difference to those around us. Life burning with an intense purity that transforms everything that it touches. That's the kind of people that we want to be in Ochterdern and Kinglassie Parish Church. Amen, and thanks be to God for that preaching from His Word. And to His name we glory, honour, praise. And our praise is 360 if you're using a hymnal, but it's on screen. Jesus Christ is waiting. Actually, we started this, but light a candle to show that the light of the world, who is Jesus Christ, shines in the darkness, and the darkness does never put out the light. And as you look to that light, let's now bow our heads and close our eyes. And we do so not for some strange ritualistic reason, but we do so we can shut out the world to some extent and wait upon God. And we call that prayer. So let's pray for our world. And I'm going slowly this morning, because rather than me listing the world's problems, I want you to think about what's heavy on your heart in terms of the world's troubles. So it may be the earthquake affecting Turkey and Syria, or it may be the war in Ukraine, or it may be other situations in the world which concern you. And lay it before God. Recognize that we are just fellow workers trying our bit to do what God wishes us to do. So ask Him for strength to do what He puts before us. And now think of those who are closer to you, who you love, whether it be family or friends. And don't just listen to my voice, but see their faces, utter their names before God, and lay them down at the feet of Jesus Christ, and know His love. And what we've done, friends, is rather than just listen to the voice of the minister and being tempted to drift, to think of things other than prayer, we've been praying for the same things, but doing so in a slightly different way. And now we gather ourselves congregationally as we pray the common prayer which Jesus taught, when we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. And what we do now in our last hymn is we look forward in faith. So it's Mark 2, 3:7 if you're using a hymnal. It's on the screen. Look forward in faith. Spirit be with each and every one of us. this day and forevermore.